about it, question is, if the distance between two consecutive base pairs is 0.34 nm and the total number of base pairs of a DNA double helix in a typical mammalian cell is 6.6 into 10 raised to 9 base pairs, then the length of the DNA is approximate. What is the length of the DNA approximate? This is very easy. You can easily answer this. Only you have to convert this. We know that total base pairs, number of base pairs in mammalian cell in our deployed cell DNA, total base pairs is 6.6 into 10 raised to 9 base pairs. Distance between two base pairs is 0.34 nm. We have to convert this because you know, we have to find out the answer in meters. So we have to convert the nanometers into meters. If we convert the nanometers into meters, it will be 0.34 nm. If we convert into meters, it will become 0.34 nm into 10 raised to 9 meters. That into 6.6 into 10 raised to 9 base pairs, if we calculate, we will get approximately 2.2 meters. That is the answer. So we will come to that. See that answer is second option, that is 2.2 meters. I will show you that procedure. The distance between two consecutive base pairs is 0.34 nm. That we have to convert it to this one, we have to convert it to meters because we need to find out the answer in meters. So 0.34 nm into 10 raised to 9 meters. The length of DNA, the length of what is the total length of DNA in our diploid cell? The length of DNA for human diploid cell is 6.6 into 10 raised to 9 base pairs. So what we have to do? We have to multiply this. Both values we have to multiply 6.6 into 10 raised to 9 base pairs into 0.34 into 10 raised to 9 meters. You have to multiply and you will get 2.2 meters approximately. You have to understand this much lengthier DNA. This much lengthier DNA is fixed in our cells. You have to understand how much complicated this process. See that this length is far greater than the dimension of a typical nucleus. See the dimension of a typical nucleus. See the dimension of a typical nucleus. It's only 10 raised to minus 6 meters. So only 10 raised to minus into the 10 raised to minus 6 meters. 2.2 meters of DNA is incorporated into that. How we can incorporate? That's why we studied. DNA is a special mechanism of DNA packaging we studied. Supercoiling, coiling of DNA. So coiling and supercoiling. After coiling and supercoiling, we fixed incorporated that much lengthier DNA, 2.2 meters of DNA into our cell. Okay, it's a very complicated mechanism we studied. Packaging of DNA, with the DNA is bound around proteins, histone proteins, and we clearly studied about the entire packaging of DNA. That's very it's a very complicated and complex process, and that helps to incorporate this lengthy DNA into our itself. Okay, so the long sized DNA can be accumulated in the small area only through packaging or compaction. That packaging only is called, that is called what? After supercoiling, we will package it in a specific way and putting into a cell. See, just consider the size of the cell and the length of the stream, 2.2 meters. Okay, so answer is 2.2 meters directly from our textually easily answerable. Only we have to convert that 0.34 nm into meters. That's all. We'll come to the 49th question. Which is the important site for the formation of glycoproteins and glycolipids in eukaryotic cells? Which is important site? Which is that organelle that is where that glycosylation process is taking place. Glycosylation of proteins and lipids are taking place. Actually, that organelle is connecting with the endoplasmic reticulum, which is Golgi bodies. You know that Golgi bodies. In Golgi bodies, actually, this also directly from this NCR, that statement is clearly given in our text, that is glycoproteins and glycolipid process, that glycosylation process taking place in the Golgi bodies. The Golgi body that is involved in mainly packaging of our proteins are taking place in Golgi bodies. After packaging and sorting and packaging, these proteins are transferring secreting into their targets. Sometimes the secretion will be to the intra target or to externalize, intracellular. Sometimes the target will be a intracellular, sometimes it will be extracellular. Golgi bodies. Golgi bodies discovered by Camillo Golgi. Okay. And what about peroxisomes? Peroxisomes are what? Peroxisomes are microbodies that can be seen in our cell. Microbodies that can be seen in our cell, which are involved in detoxification process, which are involved in peroxidation, hydrogen peroxide. Peroxidation reaction is taking place. Hydrogen peroxide conversion is detox, that hydrogen peroxide that is producing by the metabolic process have to be removed in peroxisomes. Okay, so the peroxisomes are microbodies. They are involved in detoxification process, and the peroxidation reaction can be seen in peroxisomes, microbody. Then what about polysomes? What are polysomes? Polysomes are nothing but ribosomes that can be seen in prokaryotes. In prokaryotes, we can see if mRNA is produced. When the mRNA is produced, just after the formation of mRNA, many ribosomes attach. Many ribosomes attach on the mRNA. So we can see many ribosomes attached on a single mRNA. That concept is called polyribosome. Polyribosome concept. Endoplasmic reticulum, definitely we know that endoplasmic reticulum that is involved in IS. See, endoplasmic reticulum, after production of the proteins, ribosomes transfer the protein into endoplasmic reticulum for further modification. Okay, endoplasmic reticulum are of two types, rough endoplasmic reticulum and the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Okay, so answer is Golgi bodies. Next question, it is from genetics part. Genetics 1, that is principles of inheritance and variation. Experimental verification, it is also a direct question. Experimental verification of chromosomal theory of inheritance was done by. You know that chromosomal theory of inheritance, who proposed chromosomal theory of inheritance? Sutton and Bowery proposed chromosomal theory of inheritance. Okay. Then, what about experimental verification of chromosomal theory of inheritance? Experimental verification of chromosomal theory of inheritance. Sutton and Bowery, what they did? They, along with their chromosomal theory, they studied Mendelian principles. They joined their chromosomal theory and Mendelian principles, and they come with their inheritance of chromosome they studied. Then along with that, they studied about the Mendelian principles. Then they come out with the theory of chromosomes, chromosome theory of inheritance they studied. Then verification of chromosomal theory experimentally verified by whom? Thomas Hunt Morgan. That is Thomas Hunt Morgan. Actually, Thomas Hunt Morgan, he did his experiments in fruit fly. They are known as Drosophila melanogaster. That is a fruit fly seen in the sexual reproduction, variations in sexual reproduction. He studied about that. He conducted his studies mainly in Drosophila melanogaster. Okay. We'll go to next question, number 51. This is from Anatomy of Flowering Plants. Identify the incorrect statements. Identify the incorrect statement. You have to see that go through the statement. It is from secondary growth. Secondary growth, the last part of the Anatomy of Flowering Plants. Okay, you know that sapwood and hardwood. Sapwood, when a tree is growing, secondary xylem, secondary growth. When tree become old, we can see if we cut the wood of a tree, we can see two colors. If we identify two colors, we can see inner part will be dark colored and outer part will be light colored. Okay, they are called, outer part is called what? Sapwood, and inner dark part is called what? Hardwood. Okay, so sapwood is, we have to see which one is incorrect statement. Sapwood is involved in conduction of water and minerals from root to leaf. Exactly, sapwood is the outer layer, outer peripheral layer, that through that now water is transferring from the root to the upper part of the body, plant. Okay, then trees especially. Then sapwood is the innermost secondary xylem and is lighter in color. No, sapwood is the peripheral layer. Sapwood is the outermost secondary xylem and is lighter in color, that's correct. But that is the outermost layer. Due to depositional, so this is, statement 2 is incorrect. due to deposition of tannins, resins, oils, etc. Hardwood is dark in color. Definitely, due to deposition of tannins, resins, oils, and hardwood will be dark in color, and that's why we are using those hardwood for making furnitures. Okay, because that will resist the attack of termites and pests. Then hardwood does not conduct water. Definitely, hardwood will not conduct water. That the main function of hardwood is to provide mechanical support. So what is answer? Answer, the incorrect option is sapwood is the innermost secondary cell. Actually, sapwood is the outermost. So you can see the picture here. See the sapwood. Sapwood is the lighter part, and hardwood is a dark part with the deposition of oils and tannins. That's why it becomes dark and it is more harder, and that's why we are using it for making furnitures. And nuts are transporting from the root to the upper part of the tree through this part, peripheral part, that is sapwood. Okay, sapwood is lighter in color, hardwood is darker in color. Okay, we'll go to the next question. Name the enzyme that facilitates opening of the DNA helix during transcription. Which is the enzyme that is helping for opening of DNA helix during transcription process? Which is the enzyme? DNA helicase. Actually, the DNA helicase is helping for facilitating the opening of DNA helix during which process? Replication process. That is helping during replication. DNA helix helping for opening of DNA helix during replication process. DNA polymerase is the enzyme that is helping for polymerization of DNA. That is during replication. DNA replication we are using this. Then what about RNA polymerase? RNA polymerase is the enzyme that is helping for facilitating opening of DNA helix during transcription. Don't get confused. It is RNA polymerase. Okay. And what about DNA ligase? We know that DNA ligase is known as molecular glue that is helping for joining to DNA segments. So answer is 3. Did Mendel select as pairs which were similar except in one character with the contrasting traits? Here the question is, how many plants were selected by Mendel? How many pairs of plants? Your question is, how many pairs of plants selected by Mendel? With the only one character is different. Other all characters will be same. So one contrasting characters. How many we studied? It is very clearly given in our text. That is 7 pairs of plants. 7 pairs means 14 plants. We studied about 14 plants. How many true breeding varieties, key plant varieties, did Mendel select as pairs? As pairs which were similar except in one character with the contrasting traits, that is 7 pairs, that is 14. You know that true breeding means plants which are true breeding because which are homozygous for the true breeding organism. They will these organisms will produce in the next generation also, it will produce the same characters because heterozygous genes are not the homozygous true breeding plants. So he selected 7 pairs of 7 pairs, that means 14. Then the body of ovule is fused within the funiculate. Which part of the ovule? This question is from sexual reproduction flowering plant from the 12th standard. And here the question is from anatropous. Studied the anatropous structure of the anatropous ovule. Structure of anatropous ovule, you can see the region where ovule is fusing with ovule is fused with the funicle part. That part is called what? Hilum. That part is called hilum. But what chalaza? Chalazal end, we know that the opposite end of micropylar end is called chalazal end. Nucellus is the region where more storage of nutrients can be seen through micropylar end. Ovule for transferring of male gametes to the egg. So you can see here. Here you can see hilum, the region where attaching of funicle and the region where attaching of ovule with the funicle. Then you can see the micropylar end through this, tubules are entering, pollen tube is entering. And you can see chalazal end, you can see nucellus where storage of nutrients can be seen. Okay. This is from anatropous ovule. Anatropous ovule is common type of ovule that can be seen in angiosperms. So chalazal end is the opposite end of micropyle. Chalazal end is the opposite end of the micropyle. Okay.
Yes, question number 55. Which of the following is correct about Buryats? Which of the following is correct about Buryats? Buryats, they have free RNA without protein coat. They have DNA with the protein coat. They have free DNA without protein coat. They have RNA with the protein coat. What are Buryats? We studied this one in biological classification chapter. See, Buryats are organisms which are smaller than viruses. Buryats are organisms which are smaller than viruses, which are having, there is a peculiarity for them. They are having genetic material, RNA is their genetic material, free RNA. An RNA which is not covered by a protein coat. Free RNA can be seen in Buryats. In 1971, T.O. Diner discovered Buryats, and he found that they are not covered with a protein coat. That is the peculiarity of Buryats, and their RNA is having low molecular weight. These Buryats are causing a disease called potato spindle tuber disease to plants. Okay, they are smaller than a virus with the RNA as the genetic material that is not covered by a protein coat. Normally viruses are having protein coats. They are not having protein coat. Okay, that is a peculiarity. So which is the answer? Yes, they have free DNA without protein coat. So answer is 1. We'll go to the next question. Number of substrate level phosphorylations in one turn of citric acid cycle. One turn of citric acid. You know about citric acid cycle in which the pyruvic acid is converting into pyruvic acid converted to acetyl CoA. Acetyl CoA is entering into citric acid cycle, and it will produce NADH, FADH2, and GTP. You know that. The step where formation of GTP is taking place. That is the question actually. In which step substrate level phosphorylation? What is meant by substrate level phosphorylation? Substrate level phosphorylation means conversion of, see, transferring of inorganic phosphate from a compound, from a chemical compound to ADP and convert it into ATP. That is called substrate level phosphorylation. Okay, here GTP is become, in a citric acid cycle we know that GTP is producing, the step where succinyl coenzyme is converting to succinate, GTP is forming. In that step what is happening? One GTP is formed, one GTP is equivalent to ATP. So the step where GTP formation is taking place, there we can tell that substrate level phosphorylation is taking place. Okay, substrate level phosphorylation means conversion of inorganic phosphate from one chemical molecule to ADP and converting to ATP. Here from one molecule, inorganic phosphate is transferring to guanosine diphosphate and it will converting into guanosine triphosphate. That step is, you can see that, so the answer is how many substrate level phosphorylations are taking place in one cycle of citric acid cycle? One GTP is forming during the conversion of one acetyl CoA. When it is entering into a cycle, one GTP is forming. Okay, you can see that in the step, you can see that the Krebs cycle here, acetyl CoA is converting into acetyl CoA passing through the cycle and it will produce NADPH, FADH2. These NADH, FADH2 are producing, these are using as reducing agents in an electron transport system, we know that. So this step is more important, where succinyl CoA is converting into, succinyl CoA is converting to succinate, that time what will happen? Yes, GTP is producing. So in one cycle, one GTP is producing. Okay, so the answer is 1. We'll go to the next one. So the answer here is 1. We'll go to 57th question. The products of reaction catalyzed by nitrogenase enzyme in root nodules of leguminous plants is or are. This question is from Mineral Nutrition and 11th standard. Okay. What is the peculiarity of nitrogenase enzyme? Nitrogenase enzyme is a molybdenum iron protein. All enzymes are proteins, you all know that. It's a molybdenum iron protein that is, can be able to convert atmospheric nitrogen to ammonia. Atmospheric nitrogen to ammonia. Okay, in that process, what all are the products which are producing in that process? Actually, a nitrogenase enzyme that can be seen in the nodule, root nodules, which are helping for fixing the atmospheric nitrogen to the plant. So plants highly depend upon this root nodules, especially leguminous plants, for converting that atmospheric nitrogen is one of the limiting factors for plants. For getting into the plant side, this there are we studied about rhizobium bacterium and rhizobium bacterium, which can be seen to root nodules. They are helping for which are helping for fixing the atmospheric nitrogen. In that, one of the key enzyme is nitrogenase enzyme, that is the iron molybdenum protein. Okay, the when the process completed, we will get two products. Products which are forming here are ammonia and hydrogen. So answer is ammonia and hydrogen. The third is the option. You can see the reaction here. See that enzyme. Here enzyme is nitrogenase enzyme. It is through three steps, mainly three steps of reduction. Through three steps of reduction, N2 is converting into two molecules of NH3. Ammonia is forming. Ammonia is forming. In each reduction, during converting one molecule of atmospheric nitrogen to ammonia, three steps of reduction are take place. Three steps of reduction. Okay. And another peculiarity of nitrogenase enzyme is highly sensitive to oxygen. If there is oxygen near to its vicinity, this nitrogenase enzyme cannot be able to function. For removing that oxygen from the vicinity of nitrogenase enzyme in root nodules, we can see leg hemoglobin. Hemoglobin that can be seen in leguminous plants, which are help. Here the leg hemoglobin's role is to scavenging of oxygen from the vicinity of nitrogenase enzyme. Okay. We move to the next question. Map the following with the respect to meiosis. You know that these are all the steps in meiosis. Prophase 1, meiosis, prophase, meiosis. What type of process meiosis? Meiosis can be seen in gamete cells. That is actually it's a reduction division process. See that zygotenes, very important process. Zygotene process, we know that zygotene process, what is happening? Zygotene process, homologous chromosomes will, pairing of homologous chromosomes that is taking place during zygotene process. So A can be matched with a 4. What is pacritine? Pacritine is very important step. During pacritine, that synapse, that paired chromosome started exchanging their segments. Okay. What is meant by diplotene? What is the peculiarity of diplotene? Peculiarity of diplotene. In diplotene step, what is the peculiarity? Yes. Formation of, yes, chiasmata formation can be seen. And diakinesis, peculiarity of diakinesis, terminalization. That the chiasma formation can be seen on the tips. Okay. So which is the answer? Select the correct option here and see that first will be the option. You can see the diplotene. Diplotene cell, you can see the pairing here. The pairing is taking place and the paired chromosomes moves apart and that chiasma can be seen in the terminal lens, that is for terminalization. Chiasma formation can be seen. The roots that originate from the base of the stem are, the roots which are originating from the base of the stem are known as what? The roots which are originating from the base of the stem. Normally we can see primary root with the secondary and tertiary root. That type of taproot system can be seen in, taproot system can be seen in dicot plants. And in monocot plants, we can see after the formation of primary roots. So the primary root will degenerate and many small roots will start to grow from the base of the plant. That can be seen in which plant? That can be seen in monocot plants. So fibrous root, the root that originates from the base of the plant of the stem are known as fibrous root. That is the peculiarity of monocot plants. Especially you can see in rice, wheat, and you can see this type of fibrous roots. What are prop roots? What are prop roots? Prop roots are pillars. Prop roots are roots which are producing the base of the stem, base of the stem of the plant. Especially they are helping for. Actually, they are helping the plant, giving the plant a mechanical support. You can see the prop roots in sugarcane, in maize. We can see this prop roots which are supporting the plant, which are giving support to the plant because the soil is not soil is little bit more water condenser. Then that will help the plant to support. This is like a support root, prop roots. Then what are lateral roots? Roots which are producing from the pericycle. Roots which are producing from the pericycle are known as lateral roots. Okay. So the answer is fibrous root. The root that originated from the base of the stem are known as fibrous roots. Okay. We'll go to the question 60. Slum blindness. You might have heard that is, this question is from Environmental Issues, Chapter 12 Standard. The environment with this snow blindness in Antarctic region is due to? You know that snow blindness is relating with what? It is relating with the exposure to UV light. It is relating with the exposure to UV light. Those ultraviolet rays are causing, we know that that can cause mutation. In that, no? Especially ultraviolet rays, UVB, if you got exposed to UVB light, there is a peculiarity for our eyes. This our cornea will absorb the UV light. Cornea will absorb those UVB, and that will lead to inflammation to our cornea, and that can lead to snow blindness and to cataract. The peculiarity is that can even lead to permanent loss of vision. So that is a problem with going to the daylight, which is where UV light is more prominent. That can, if you look into that, if more UV light is there, our cornea will absorb it, and it can lead to inflammation of cornea, can lead to snow blindness, blindness, and to what? Cataract, and this can lead to loss of vision. Okay, very important. So, high reflection of light from snow? No. What is snow blindness? Is inflammation of cornea due to high dose of UVB radiation. High inflammation of reflection of light from snow. Damage to retina caused by infrared rays. Here there is no infrared rays, UV rays only. Freezing of fluids in the eye by low temperature. Now, answer is what? See the math the following again from mineral nutrition chapter. What is the use of iron in the plants? Math the following concerning essential elements and their functions in plants. Iron is very useful for repairing. It is used for production of biosynthesis of chlorophyll. And is very much essential for biosynthesis of chlorophyll. Okay. Then zinc. Zinc is one of the important mineral for the formation of very important plant hormone, indole 3 acetic acid. Indole 3 acetic acid, IAA. For IAA biosynthesis, plants need what? Zinc. So B can be matched with 4, A can be matched with 3. Boron is very important for pollen germination. We know that for pollen germination, boron is very essential. Boron inositol complex. We studied boron inositol. This boron inositol. You might have heard boron inositol complex. By sensing the boron inositol complex, that pollen tube is moved towards boron inositol complex. Then, but its manganese is very important for splitting of water. Splitting of water takes place in which light reaction step? With light reaction process in non-cyclic photophosphorylation, photolysis of water is taking place. That photolysis water splitting mechanism, it needs, that machinery needs manganese. This is another mineral that is needed for this photolysis, chlorine. Okay. So answer is yes, 2. What are ray florets? Do you all know that ray florets of sunflower? It's an example for what? It's a direct question. Ray florets of sunflower is an example for inferior ovary. That's an example for inferior ovary. Epigynous. Inferior ovary. Superior ovary is also known as definitely hypogynous ovary. Superior ovary can be seen in mustard. You know that superior ovary can be seen in mustard, China rose. Then what about half inferior ovary? Half inferior ovary can be seen in plum, peach, rose and all. Half inferior ovary is also known as perigynous ovary. And inferior ovary is epigynous ovary. Ray florets of sunflower is an example for inferior ovary. Then, Montreal Protocol was signed in 1987. Where is Montreal? Montreal is in Canada. That was actually, it was a very important summit that happened in Canada in 1987. But it became functional in 1989 onwards. And Montreal is a place in Canada where that all world countries were very concerned about the emission of ozone depleting substances. So answer is emission of ozone depleting substances. Answer option is second option, release of greenhouse effects. Now disposal of e-waste, reduced transport of genetically modified organisms from one country to another country. No, ozone depleting substances. That's answer. Okay, become that protocol become functional from 1989 onwards. Meiotic division of the secondary oocyte is completed. When it is completed? At the time of fusion of sperm with an ovum. We know that clearly. Okay.
So the answer is Answer here is at the time of fusion of a sperm with an ovum. Then we will go to question number 65. The oxygenation activity of Rubisco enzyme in photorespiration leads to the formation of what? What is meant by oxygenation? Oxygenation activity of Rubisco enzyme in photorespiration leads to the formation of what? You know that Rubisco is having two substrates. Rubisco can bind the two substrates mainly. It can bind with the oxygen, it can bind with the carbon dioxide. If it binds with the carbon dioxide, definitely it can lead to formation, that is dark reaction will take place, that leads to formation of glucose. Rubisco is having affinity towards oxygen also. If Rubisco binds with oxygen, that can form phosphoglycolate and phosphoglyceric acid. And that is a process called photorespiration. That's a futile process that will not produce any useful product. So Rubisco's that activity, binding of Rubisco with the oxygen is known as photorespiration. That process is called photorespiration. If it binds with the oxygen, you can see that that will produce one 3-carbon compound, that is phosphoglyceric acid, and one 2-carbon compound, that is a phosphoglycolate. One 3-carbon compound and one 2-carbon compound. One 3-carbon compound and one 2-carbon compound. Okay, so you then to see the options. The oxygenation activity of Rubisco enzyme in photorespiration leads to formation of one molecule of 3-carbon compound. No. One molecule of 3-carbon compound, not only one molecule of 3-carbon compound. Definitely, one molecule of 3-carbon compound is producing 100%, that is PGA. And one molecule of 2-carbon compound, that is phosphoglycolate. One molecule of 6-carbon compound? No. One molecule of 4-carbon compound and one molecule of 2-carbon compound? No. Two molecule of 3-carbon compounds. So which is the answer? Most probable answer is yes, one molecule of 3-carbon compound definitely it is producing. Next is a one molecule of a 2-carbon compound. That is phosphoglycolate. Okay. So which is the answer? Correct answer is yes. This is the correct answer. Here you can see that process. Here you can see when Rubisco binds with oxygen, it will form phosphoglycolate. Phosphoglycolate is a 2-carbon compound and PG is a 3-carbon compound. So as per our answer, the compounds formed are one molecule of 3-carbon compound definitely is formed. So the answer is what? Photorespiration is also known as C2 cycle, because first forming compound is phosphoglycolate is forming, so it's a C2 cycle. We know that the dark reaction is also known as C3 cycle. Okay, we'll move to the next question. Question number 65. Which of the following pairs is a unicellular algae? Very easy, direct question. Which of the following are unicellular algae? Gracilidae and Velidae are not unicellular algae. They are coming from red algae. Anabaena and Volvox, no. They are not the unicellular algae. And here Volvox is known as, say, colony forming algae coming under chlorophase. Chlorella and spirulina, we studied. Chlorella and spirulina are unicellular algal varieties. Unicellular algal varieties. Chlorella and spirulina are unicellular algal varieties. And so the answer is 3. In Laminaria and Sargassum, all of you know, they are coming under brown algae. Okay. Next. In light reaction, sir, little bit tricky question. In light reaction, plastophenone facilitates the transfer of electrons from plastophenone. Plastophenone facilitate the transfer of electrons from cytochrome B6 complex to PS1. You know that in light reaction plastophenone transferring to B6 facilitate electron transfer. That can be seen in a light reaction. Non-cyclic photophosphorylation. Non-cyclic light reaction, that is non-cyclic photophosphorylation. We can see this in the electron emitting from the photosphere 2 is going to the cytochrome B6F complex. Cytochrome B6F complex through plastophenone. You can see that. So the answer is PS2 to cytochrome B6F complex. You can see that the enzyme that is producing, the electron, this electron that is releasing from P680, electron that is releasing from P680 is accepting by the primary electron acceptor, then it is going to cytochrome complex that we mentioned in the question, through plus two phenol. See that, through plus two phenol. So the answer is, that's why the answer is PS22 cytochrome B6 complex. In between you can see plus two phenol. Okay, then select the correct match. The question is from genetics part, select the correct match. These are all genetic diseases. See that phenylketonuria. What is phenylketonuria? Phenylketonuria is an autosomal dominant disease. No, phenylketonuria is an autosomal recessive disease. Phenylketonuria is due to mutation in the gene that can be seen in which chromosome? Which chromosome you can see that? Chromosome number 12. The gene, the chromosome number 12 got mutated and that is affecting the, that leads to phenylketonuria. Phenylketonuria is due to deficiency of mutation in the gene for which enzyme? Phenylalanine hydroxylase enzyme. If phenylalanine hydroxylase enzyme is not functional, that leads to accumulation of phenylalanine. That will affect the brain tissues. Okay. Then, what about, so phenylketonuria is a autosomal recessive disease. So that the first one is incorrect. What about second one? Sickle cell anemia. Sickle cell anemia is autosomal recessive trait. Exactly correct. The gene for sickle cell anemia can be seen in chromosome 11. Exactly correct. So second one is correct. What about thalassemia? Thalassemia is an X-linked disease. No. Thalassemia is also a autosomal recessive disease. Thalassemia is also an autosomal recessive disease. Thalassemia, you know that what is thalassemia, that in thalassemia patients we can see improper production of alpha or beta polypeptides. Sometimes the alpha polypeptides will be alpha polypeptides of hemoglobin number will be more. Some cases beta polypeptides number will be more. Improper production, that is actually alpha and beta should be in balanced numbers, but improper production of formation of alpha or beta in hemoglobin of thalassemic patient, so that can lead to type of anemia. If it is alpha thalassemia, means alpha polypeptide production is high. Okay, alpha thalassemia, alpha polypeptide production is high, and beta thalassemia means beta polypeptide production is low. Both those cases can be seen. Normally, we can see thalassemia affecting genes can be seen in chromosome number 16 and chromosome number 11. And what about hemophilia? Hemophilia is definitely, we all know that hemophilia is an X-linked disease. So, which is the correct statement? The correct one is, correct matching is sickle cell anemia. It is an autosomal recessive trait from chromosome 11. Okay. Then, it's a question from ecology part. Organism and the population of 12th chapter. Which of the following is not an attribute of a population? Which of the following is not connecting with the population attributes? See that easily we can answer. No? Species interaction. Why? Because natality, you know, natality, birth rate, more number of births happening at a particular time in the population. Mortality means death rate. The number of deaths happening in a population at a particular time. Then species interaction. Species interaction is not connecting with the population attribute. Okay, that is dealing with the interactions that is happening in the nature. That is not connected with population interaction. But sex ratio, definitely male-female ratio in a population is also a population attribute. So the answer is species interaction. And we'll go to question number 70. Which of the following statements about inclusion bodies is incorrect? Now that inclusion, what are the inclusion bodies? Inclusion bodies are seen in, especially these inclusion bodies can be seen in prokaryotic cells. In prokaryotic cells, we can see the storage of nutrients, storage of food items. They were stored in the nutrients, food items were stored in the prokaryotic cells in inclusion bodies. These inclusion bodies actually these are involved in ejection of food particles. No, they are not involved in ejection process. They are not at all involved in ejection process. That storage molecules. Storage molecules are seen in the inclusion bodies. They lie free in the cytoplasm. Actually, these inclusion bodies can be seen lie in the cytoplasm. You can see that these represent reserve material in cytoplasm. They can be reserved material. Reserved material are stored in the inclusion bodies and they can be seen in the cytoplasm. That is also a correct statement. And what about the fourth statement? They are not bound by any membrane. They are very small physical structures. They are not bound by. They are not membrane bound. That is also correct. So fourth statement is also correct. Which of the following is incorrect about inclusion body? So which is incorrect one? Incorrect one is these are involved in. They are not at all involved in ejection of food particles. These are involved in ejection of food particles. Is incorrect statement. All other statements are correct. So answer is one. Examples for inclusion bodies, cyanophysin granules, glycogen granules, and this can be seen in prokaryotic cells. Okay. We'll go to question number 71. The transverse section of a plant shows following anatomical features. If we take this transverse section of a plant, we can see the following anatomical features. As per the features, we have to find out what type of, which part of the plant is that. Okay. Large number of scattered vascular bundles. If you take the section of the plant, we can see large number of vascular bundles. So vascular bundles are scattered. Scattered vascular bundles are scattered in the section. Scattered vascular bundles. We studied that scattered vascular bundles are specific for particular plants. Then large conspicuous parenchyma tissues in between the vascular bundles. Then vascular bundles are conjoined and closed. That's very important. Vascular bundles are conjoined and closed. Closed vascular bundles can be seen only in dicots or monocots. That can be seen only in monocots. Closed vascular bundles. Closed vascular bundles means there is no secondary growth. There is no cambium can be seen. So closed vascular bundles. Vascular bundles are closed. That means they are monocot organs, monocot plants. And the phloem parenchyma is completely absent. Phloem parenchyma is absent. And let us see the options. See that. Monocot plant with a monocot stem with the scattered vascular bundles. In between that we can see parenchymatous tissues and these vascular bundles are closed vascular bundles. So the answer is identify the category of plant and its parts. Monocotyledonous root. No, it is not a root. Dicot stem. No, because it is closed. Closed vascular bundles with the scattered vascular bundles. Scattered vascular bundles can be seen in dicot root or monocot stem. Which is answer? Monocot stem. Okay, and we'll go to question number 72. In relation to gross primary productivity, and net primary productivity of an ecosystem, which one of the following statements is correct? What is gross primary productivity? The amount of biomass, organic matter produced by photosynthesis. The amount of organic matter produced by photosynthesis is known as gross primary productivity. Gross primary productivity means the amount of biomass produced by photosynthesis. That is called gross primary productivity. What is meant by net primary productivity? Net primary productivity, amount of biomass that is storing in plants, that have to be transferred to the next generation, that have to be transferred to the consumers. Plants are producers. So actually GPP, the amount of biomass that is producing by photosynthesis is from that by GPP, some amount of energy is utilizing by the plants for its respiration, for its energy, for its activities, that some amount of energy is utilizing by the plant. Okay, so net, what is NPP? Net primary productivity means net primary productivity is equal to GPP minus respiratory rate. Energy that is used for plant's respiration. GPP minus respiratory rate is called net primary productivity. That net primary productivity is transferring to the consumers. So GPP will be always greater than net primary productivity. So GPP will be always more than NPP. Gross primary productivity is always more than the net primary productivity. It's correct. Gross primary productivity and net primary productivity are one and same. No, it won't be same. GPP will be always high. There is no relation between gross primary productivity and net primary productivity. Definitely there is a relation. Gross primary productivity is always less than net primary productivity. So this answer is 1. Okay, we'll go to next question. Question number 73. Water hyacinth and water lily, pollination takes place by. By looking at the question, you will think that water hyacinth and water lily, see, both may be hydrophilic plants. Actually, the peculiarity is water hyacinth and water lily. The peculiarity is these plants rooted in floor of the water bud, and this will emerge from the water. This will emerge from the water. So naturally, the flowers will be emerging from the water. So naturally, these flowers are pollinated by insects or insect pollinators or wind pollination. So answer will be insects or winds. Okay, insect or wind. So option 4. We go to the next question. The process responsible for facilitating loss of water in liquid form from the tip of grass blades at night and in early morning is, what is the process? Losing of water through the tip of the grass blades and at night and in the early morning, that is called guttation. Which is the due to which force water is coming through the hydatids at the openings where water is losing through the tip of the leaves, that is, that things are called hydatids. Actually, that guttation process is due to what? Actually, guttation process, the force behind the guttation process is what? Force behind the guttation process is root pressure, impipation, plasmolysis, transpiration. Which is the force behind that? This root pressure, the pressure created in the roots. When pressure created in the roots, when plants absorb the minerals and ions from the soil into the root cells, naturally the concentration in the root cells will increase. So when concentration in the root cells increase, naturally more water will come into the roots. This will create a pressure. That pressure is called root pressure. Root pressure is the reason behind the losing of water in liquid form from the tip of the grass blades at night and in early morning. This root pressure is the reason for guttation. What is impipation? Impipation is absorption of solid molecule by the water is absorbing by a solid molecule, that is called impipation. Normally, plant seeds will germinate after absorbing water. That is an example for impipation. What is plasmolysis? Plasmolysis means if you put a cell in a hypertonic solution, naturally water will lose from the cell, and the plasma membrane of the cell will shrink and plasmolyze. That shrink, the cell will shrink, because if you put a cell in hypertonic solution, naturally it will create a plasmolysis. Plasma membrane of the cell will shrink. It's called plasmolysis. Transpiration is losing of water through the stomata of the leaves. That is called the evaporation of water evaporated through the water in the form of gas. That is water vapor. It is evaporated through the stomata of the leaves. It's called as transpiration. Okay. We'll move to the question number 75. Which of the following is not an inhibitory substance governing seed dormancy? Is it abscisic acid? No. Abscisic acid is an inhibitory substance. Then phenolic acid, that's also an inhibitory substance. Para ascorbic acid is also having effect on inhibition of the that is also an inhibitory substance. Here the only exception is gibberellic acid. Okay, so answer is gibberellic acid. Then we'll go to question number 76. According to Robert May, the global species diversity is about. He studied in biodiversity chapter, he studied about predictions of environmentalists regarding the total, they are predicting the amount, number of species that can be seen in the entire earth. You know that. See, and some extremists extremists for predicted that there may be 20 to 50 million species of animals can be seen in the earth. But that cannot be able to take into consideration, because that is just an extreme view. That's an extreme view. But Robert May proposed, they proposed this species diversity, number of species that can be seen by a scientific way. He proposed that there may be a chance for 7 million species can be seen on Earth. 7 million species. Among the 7 million species, what about 1.5 million? According to IUCN, International Union for Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources, according to IUCN, they predict the number of plants and animal species which were identified and named. How many were identified and named? 1.5 million plants and animals were identified and named. That the data about these organisms are with us. 1.5 million. So, according to Robert May, the global number of global species diversity is about 7 million. So, answer is 3. Okay, we'll go to question number 77. Match the topic level with the, their correct species examples in grassland ecosystem. Just to see that, see the peculiarity for the topic level. What is the peculiarity of fourth topic level? Fourth topic level, second topic level, first topic level, third topic level. You can see that. See, we have to match that. Which will be the first tropical? Normally, we all know that in an ecosystem, the first of all, the producers. Producers will be first tropical, so it will be first tropical. Definitely, C will be grass. Then, grass is taken by consumers, primary consumers. Grass is taken by the rabbit. So, rabbit will be the second tropical level. Then, third tropical level may be what? Third tropical level definitely will be crow. Crow. They are omnivorous organisms. They will take small insects, small for rodents and all. So, crow will be the third tropic level, and what will be the fourth tropic level? Higher consumer. Higher consumer will be, here the higher consumer will be vulture. Vulture is higher consumer. So, first tropic level grass, second tropic level rabbit, third tropic level crow, and fourth tropic level is vulture. So, answer is four. We'll go to question number 78. The first phase of translation is, it's a question from molecular basic inheritance. What is the first statement of translation? What is meant by translation? Translation means conversion of mRNA to protein with the help of ribosomes. What is the first step in translation? You know that first step in translation is, first step in translation, recognition of DNA molecule, amino acylation of tRNA, recognition of an anticodon, binding of mRNA to ribosome. First process of is called what? First process of this is activation of amino acids and its corresponding tRNA. Activation of amino acids and its corresponding tRNA. That is the first process. First process of translation is activation of amino acids and its corresponding tRNA. That is the first process. This process is activating by the enzyme, that is catalyzing by the enzyme amino acyl tRNA synthetase. Amino acyl tRNA synthetase is the enzyme. Amino acyl tRNA synthetase enzyme activating the process of amino acylation of tRNA. That is the first step in the translation process. Okay. In go to question number 79. Strobili or corns are found. You know that strobili and corns we can see. In which plants we can see strobili and corns? Normally we can see in pteridophytes like Selaginella and Equisetum, we can see what? Strobili and corns. So this sporophytes modified and formed. The sporophytes will form a corn shaped strobili in the tip. Actually, these can be here. This is question from Plant Kingdom. Here the options are Pteris, Marcantia, Equisetum, and Salvinia. So which is the correct one? Equisetum. In Equisetum, we can see this strobili. Then what about Pteris? Pteris is coming out of this. Pteris is a pteridophyte. Marcantia is what? Marcantia is a bryophyte variety, and the Salvinia is also a pteridophyte. What type of pteridophyte? It's an aquatic. this aquatic development. Okay. Then we'll go to question number 80. Here you can see that, see the EPC term with the stromali. Stromali are also known as corals. We'll go to question number 80. Some dividing cells exit the cell cycle. Some dividing cells exit the cell cycle and enter into vegetative inactive stage. This is a called what stage? Fusion stage. This process occurs at the time of. You know that some cells, for example, cells like heart cells. Heart cells will hardly divide. They will not divide. Brain cells, which will not divide. One swarm which will not divide. The peculiarity of these cells, some of the cells will divide only at a particular time. If they need, if they had some injury or some losing of their cells, then only this cells, this tissue, organ, cells of that organs will divide. They will divide very rarely. In that case, after the M phase, the cell, this cell cycle trans, these cell will move into a stage called the Fusion stage or G0 stage. They will move to a stage called Fusion stage or G0 stage. So, go to the options. G1 phase, S phase, G2 phase, M phase. A cell is moving to Fusion stage after, at the end of which stage? M phase. After M phase, after mitotic phase, the cell is moving to the Fusion stage or G0 phase. Then they will come back to the G1 phase. If it is needed, then they will come back to the G1 phase for completing the further division. When they reach coming to the G1 phase, definitely it will complete the division process. Okay. So answer is M phase. Then we will come to the next question. Question 81. The plant parts which consists of two generations, one within the another. Which one is having two generations? Pollen grains inside the anther, germinated pollen grain with the two male gametes, seed inside the fruit, embryo sac inside the ovum. So very easy question. You know that pollen grains inside the anther, pollen grains are having, you know that pollen grains are having, they are having two generations are carrying by them. Germinated pollen grain, no. Germinated pollen grain with the two male gametes, they are not having two germinations. Seed is having, you know, that seed is forming from ovule, from the seed new generation is developing. Seed is carrying two generations. Then what about embryo sac inside the ovule? Embryo sac inside the ovule is not carrying two generations. So we just answer is A and D only. Okay. Pollen grain inside the anther. Sorry, pollen grain inside the anther is carrying this two generation. Seed is not carrying, embryo sac inside the ovule is carrying. That's why A and D. Okay. Not seed, embryo sac inside the ovule is carrying two generation. So answer is A and D. Then go to question number 82. Dissolution of synaptonemal complex. Already we discussed that. Then that after the formation of synaptonemal complex, when it is the synaptonemal complex which started to start to separate, the synaptonemal complex started to separate, in which stage? You know that it is in diplotting stage. Then they can be see attached only on specific region. These regions are known as chiasmata. Okay, we go to this number 83. The ovary that is half inferior in, we already discussed about inferior ovary in array, sunflower, and here which is inferior, half inferior ovary is known as perigynous ovary, can be seen in plum. Perigynous ovary can be seen in plum, peach, rose, and we can see half inferior perigynous ovary. In mustard, we can see superior ovary. Sunflower, we can see inferior ovary, and brinjal also showing superior ovary. Superior ovary is known as hypogynous ovary. Okay. Question number 84. Identify the correct statement with regard to G1 phase. G1 phase is also known as gap phase 1. Identify the correct statement with regard to G1 phase of interphase. Option 1, reorganization of all cell components takes place. Cell is metabolically active, grows, but does not replicate its DNA. Option 3 is nuclear division takes place. Option 4, DNA synthesis or replication takes place. What's the peculiarity of G1 phase? In G1 phase, actually, cell is metabolically active. Cell is preparing for the process of replication that have to be takes place in the next phase, that is S phase. So Ocelli is metabolically very active, but it does not replicate, because replication of DNA takes place in this phase, synthetic phase, S phase. So this answer, most probable answer here is cell is metabolically active, grows but does not replicate its DNA. Replication of DNA takes place in S phase. So answer is, answer here is yes. 2. Cell is metabolically active but does not replicate its DNA. Okay. We go to question number 85. Mint plant growth regulator, which upon spraying on sugarcane crop increases its length of stem, thus increasing the yield of sugarcane crop. Which is that? So direct question, you know that the plant hormone that is responsible for increasing the internodal length, of plant hormone that is responsible for increasing the internodal length, which one is that hormone? Gibberellins. Direct question, gibberellins. Answer is gibberellin. And you know that what is ethylene? Ethylene is a gaseous hormone, abscisic acid. That is a drought hormone, that is also known as drought hormone, that will protect, that will help the plant during the time of drought for conserving water. Cytokines will activate cell growth, that is a growth promoter actually. Growth promoters, ethylene and abscisic acids are growth retarders. Okay, so for one of the main functions of gibberellin is increasing the internodal length. If you spray that gibberellin, that will increase the stem length of the sugarcane crop. Naturally, that will increase the production of sugarcane. Okay, so option 1. Question 86. Identify the wrong statement with reference to the gene I that controls ABO blood group. All of you knows that this gene I that is controlling blood group, or blood group is an example for multiple alleles. Why it is called an example for multiple alleles? Here gene I is having more than two alternate forms. Correct? They are having more than one allele. More than one allele is there. That means if I only, I zero, I represents what? Which blood group? O blood group. If I is not having any of the, I is responsible for A blood group, IB is responsible for B blood group. Actually, what is meant by A and B blood group? A blood group means persons who are having A blood group will be having a sugar residue. They will be having a sugar residue, specific sugar residue on the plasma membrane of this RBC. Sugar residue. Which is that sugar residue? That is galactosamine. Galactosamine is a sugar molecule that can be seen on the plasma membrane of RBC of blood groups, persons with the blood group A. And those who are having blood group B will be having a sugar moiety known as galactose. Those who are having blood group A and B will be having both galactosamine and galactose. This is the peculiarity. So this is an example for multiple alleles. So with that understanding, you have to come to the options. Option 1, a person will have only two of the three alleles. Exactly, it is correct. So our question is, which is the wrong statement regarding this ABA blood group? A person will have only two of the three alleles. Definitely, a person will be having, one option is II, other option is IA, one I, IA, IA, IB, IB, IA, IB. Any of the two options can be, any of the two of three alleles can be seen. That is also first statement is correct. When IA, IA, IB are present, for example, IA and IB are present, that means person with AB blood group, they express same type of sugar. No, in AB blood group, they express two types of sugars. One is galactosamine, and other one is galactose. Both type of sugars can be seen because both allele of the gene I will express. IA express galactosamine and I express galactose. So when A and B are present together, they represent same type of sugar. That is incorrect. They represent two types of sugar. Then Next one, allyl I does not produce any sugar. Definitely, I, if only allyl I is there, that does not produce any sugar. If IA is there, it will produce galactose. I mean, IB is there, it will produce galactose. The gene I has three alleles. Exactly, the gene I has three alleles. I, IA, IB. See that for your, so which is answer? It's very clear, the wrong statement is 2. For your understanding, given here immunodominant sugars, dominant sugars which can be seen in A blood group and B blood group. Those who are having A blood group in their blood cells, plasma membrane, we can see N-acetyl-D-galactosamine. That's why I told you about galactosamine. Then even those who are having B blood group will be having galactose in their surface. Okay. So those who are having A and AB blood group will be having two of the sugar moieties, sugar substance molecule that can be expressed on the plasma membrane of the RBC. Okay. So the next question, Floridian starch has structure similar to what? What is Floridian starch? The Floridian starch we studied. This is a question from relating with the plant kingdom. So Floridian starch has a structure similar to what? Floridian starch is, first you have to understand what is Floridian starch. Floridian starch is a storage molecule in red algae. That's the storage molecule in red algae. Floridian starch is it is a carbohydrate that is having structural similarity with amylopectin and glycogen, mannitol and algin, laminarin and cellulose, starch and cellulose. Is the correct answer? Yes, Floridian starch is like amylopectin and glycogen. Their structure is like amylopectin and glycogen. More branched structure. It's a branched structure. Amylopectin and glycogen are branched structures. They are coiled branched structure. Okay, branched structure can be seen in amylopectin and glycogen. Floridian starch is also having similar structure. That is storage form of the carbohydrate, storage form in red algae. Okay, so answer is amylopectin and glycogen. Then what is meant by mannitol and algin? Mannitol is a storage form that can be seen in Phaeophyce or brown algae. And what is meant by algin? Algin is the outermost. Algin is a gelatinous covering that can be seen in, where that can be seen on this outermost part of the cell wall of brown algae. Then what about laminarin? Laminarin is also in brown algae. We can see two storage forms, mannitol and laminarin can be seen. Mannitol and laminarin can be seen in brown algae. Cellulose is the is carbohydrate molecule that is used for making cellulose, can be seen in cell wall of plant cells. Then starch, storage form of carbohydrate in plants. Okay. So answer is 1. Floridian starch is having more similarity with the starches in the amylopectin and glycogen. Okay. This question is from plant growth and humus. Plant growth and development this chapter. The process of growth is maximum during. The process of growth is maximum during in which phase? Very, very easy question, but the question is connecting with the sigmoid growth curve. In your NCERT, you can see a sigmoid growth curve relating with the plant growth. In any plant, one plant is taken into one place, for example, a small plantlet is taken into a new soil, for example, that is planted on a new soil, it will take some days to acclimatize with the new environment, adjust adapting with the new environment. So the growth will be very slow. Growth can be seen by the plantlet. Slowly it adapted with the environment, it started to grow very fastly. So that time you can see the very fast exponential growth can be seen. Then when it reaches up to a particular level, their growth will become slow down and it will be in a stationary manner. You can see that the growth of the trees, if you observe the growth of the trees, you can see that when it reaches up to a particular level, then growth will be in a stationary manner. Okay. So this type of this question was relating with the sigmoid growth curve that is given in our text relating with the plant growth. So in which stage we can see maximum growth? Maximum this growth can be seen in lag phase, slow growth, senescence means period between reproductive maturity and death. Period between reproductive maturity and death is called senescence. Dormancy means inactive stage. Log phase means maximum growth can be seen in log phase. or exponential phase? The answer is 4. You can see that for your reference, you can see this sigmoid growth curve. Here you can see plant slowly, if you plant a new plantlet in a new soil, it started to grow very slowly. It have to adapt to the new environment, then started to grow. After adapting the environment, its growth will be very faster, and you can see exponential growth. Then after reaching a particular stage, its growth will become slower and it will begin, and it will appear in a stationary phase. Okay. We'll go to 89th question. Which of the following regions of the globe, in which part of the region of the globe exhibits highest species diversity, maximum species diversity can be seen? Madagascar region, Himalayas, Amazon forest, Western Ghats. Is this answer? Madagascar, Himalayas, Amazon forest, Western Ghats. You know that when comparing these places, the place that is known as the length of the earth, this is the length of the earth, that is Amazon forest. Amazon forest is having maximum species diversity. Question gets on coming after that. Amazon forest is showing maximum species diversity. So the answer here is 3. We are coming to the last question. The sequence that controls the copy number of linked DNA in the vector is termed as the sequence. If you take a plasmid vector, the sequence in that plasmid vector that controls the copy number, the replication of the plasma or that vector, it is controlling by what? The replication of the vector is controlled by a region known as ORI sequence. That region is known as ORI sequence. This is that region? ORI sequence. You know about palindromic sequence, where that restriction genes are cutting the genetic material. Recognition sites were identified by some enzymes. They are called recognition sites. We studied about selectable markers, which are used for identifying the transformed cells. They are used for identifying the transformed cells. Okay. By this, we are completing this biology discussion part. Once again, thank you for all of you.